Hey guys, hello everyone. This is actually a first attempt by me to show you a game analysis of a game I played actually just yesterday. And I thought it would be nice to try to do it over a real chess board, as you can see here. So I've tried really my best to adjust to the lights and to the actual size of the board, to the camera. So actually I want to really enjoy this video using in actual chess pieces. I figured that many of the viewers mainly play chess online these days. It's not very common, at least not for all players, to use a real chess board. This is actually a wooden chess board, very nice one. I use it for myself, for the lessons I give, and also if I play with the friends or colleagues. I really like this chess board, and I want to show you a very instructive game. At least I find it very instructive. It's a game which really, throughout the whole game, you would see that it basically combines attacking ideas and defensive ideas all mixed up together. So the theme of this game would be combining defense and attack together in a game in order to eventually reach a successful situation where you can execute your own ideas while still thinking about your opponent's attack also, and also manage not to allow him to execute his own attacking ideas. So this was a rapid game. So it means that each player gets 20 minutes plus 5 seconds. It's a fairly fast time control. It's not a full time control. So white started with a pawn to e4. By the way, I was playing with the white pieces. I forgot to mention. My opponent was a very promising young player from Israel. I think rated about 2400. So he played pawn to c5. So we have the Sicilian defense. We have knight f3. d6, d4, c takes d4, knight takes on d4, knight f6, knight to c3, and now I went with my pawn to a6. He went to the pawn to a6, so this is the so-called Neidorf variation of the Sicilian. Very popular, it was implemented by many strong players like Garry Kasparov, Bobby Fischer, of course Magnus Carlsen, Vichy Anand. A lot of elite chess players choose this as one of their weapons with the black pieces. So I played here the move bishop to e3, which is one of the most common moves here. My opponent played the move e5, attacks the knight on d4, so my knight was forced to retreat. He played his bishop to e6. So you see that in these positions, many times, many of the black pieces, you see the bishop, the knight and the queen, a lot of the time aim towards pushing his pawn to d5, trying to support this kind of pawn break. This is why in the future, many times there is a little kind of a battle between white and black about who is going to be first, whether black would be in time to push with d5 or whether white would be able to stop it and basically avoid black from getting an immediate counterattack in the center. In this position, the main move is pawn to f3. This move has two ideas: to protect the pawn on e4, but also to support later on white's attacking ideas involving the move g4. This is the main move. I chose to play the move pawn to h3, which is a slightly more tricky move. So it has a similar point to support my pawn from advancing to the square on g4, and also stopping his own pieces from ever landing on this square because they would get captured. Black now played the move h6. I personally don't like this move so much. I think his idea was to anticipate my coming g4 move by already being able to protect the square on g5 and thus not allowing my pawn to advance so easily on g5. But I think this move is basically a little bit premature. I think as black I would prefer to develop some pieces. Knight d7 looks like a very sensible move, preparing on the next move to bring his rook into the game, put some pressure on the c file. Also the move bishop e7 makes a lot of sense, getting ready to castle the king. He chose to play h6. And one of the main plans of white in this position is to eventually to castle his king on the long side, to castle long. This is why it's very important to move my queen out of the way. There are two ways to do it. Queen d2 is a very standard way to continue, and later on to castle the king to the queen side. I chose to play the move queen to f3, which is a slightly unusual move. Or at least it used to be a very unusual square for the queen, but actually in recent times this kind of approach is very popular. The queen, not only preparing the queen for getting castled on the queen side, but the queen is also might interrupt black's king when he is on the king side. When he eventually castles short, the white queen might be able to play queen g3 to put some pressure on the pawn on g7. And also, one of the advantages of the queen on f3, it's not blocking the rook. So if at some point white is playing the move long castle, you see that the open file for the rook is completely opened up. There is no queen in front of him that slightly interrupts with his activity. So, queen to f3. My opponent now played his knight to d7. Very sensible move. Knight castled long. Now you can also see one of the points about the move h3. If I would not play this little move, my opponent would now have this move, bishop g4, attacking the queen, and also later on attacking the rook, thus winning material. So thanks to this move is not really possible. So my opponent chose to develop one more piece into the game, bishop to e7. You see the black has a very nice cluster of pieces in the center. This is actually a very classic formation for the knight of defense. And black is ready to castle at any given moment. So in this position, I really wanted to start already my own attack on the king side, because very soon the black king will castle on this side, my king is going to be castled on the queen side. So it means that I really want to attack his king on that side of the board, very far away from my own king, which is very safe on the queen side, and he would try to attack on this side of the board with his own pawns and pieces. But before doing it, I chose to play one prophylactic move just to safeguard my position a little bit before going for the attack. So I chose to play the move king to b1. So this move has a lot of advantages. You will see them also later on, that this move is very, very useful. So for example, the king now protects the pawn on a2. Also, the square on c1 is being vacated. So sometimes I can use this square for some of my pieces, the knight, the bishop, the rook, for some defensive purposes. So this is a universally useful move. Now, black played the move b5. That's a very sensible move. He's already initiating his own attack on the queen side. And very soon, the battle would begin. So with this move, black might also aim at pushing my knight out of the way. So I chose to play the move knight to d5, to the center. You can see that this knight is very well supported by my pawn, the rook, and the queen, so there is not really danger for this knight. Black cannot really stand this knight, he has to take it. Notice that he must take with the bishop, because if he takes with the knight, then pawn takes d5, and the black bishop is lost. If you can see, he has no squares to escape without getting captured. So bishop takes d5, pawn takes d5. So this pawn is actually kind of nice in the center, because it controls this nice square on c6. If I can ever get my knight to land on this square on c6, it could be a terrific strategic achievement for white, because this knight is not very easily being chased away from its square, and it attacks the queen and the bishop. Basically, black must not allow this knight ever to get into this square. Or for this matter, for any white piece, it's very dangerous for him to allow to get to the c6 square. Very weak square, which is supported by the pawn. So, finally, black castled. So, I think in this moment, both sides are ready to start initiating their attacks. So, I play the move g4. This move that we have been anticipating a lot of moves ago, already when I played the move h3. So the white plan now involves at some point pushing my pawn to g5, opening up either the g file or the h file in front of his king. So very possibly my next move is going to be the pawn to h4, and with these two pawns together I can either break with g5, or I can further support it with a move like rook g1 and only then push the pawn. And because of this h6 move, remember that I told you that I don't really like this move by him. Thanks to this move, when I play g5, he will always have to capture the pawn, and it will help me to open up lines against his king, which is at the moment safe, but it might not be once these files might get opened up. So g4 was played. He played the move knight to b6. A good move, putting pressure on the pawn on d5. This knight is also a very jumpy piece. It might jump at some point to c4, and it might also jump to a4 to support black's attack against my king. So I continue my plan with h4. This pawn is being protected two times, so at the moment it cannot be taken. But black now played the move e4, which I think he was probably very happy about playing, because now it attacks my queen. Now after my queen went to g2, he could take my pawn on d5, which now has one defender and one defender on d1, and one attacker and two attackers basically, so black could take it. But I was actually not so much worried about it. First of all, if I want to just regain the pawn, I can now take this pawn on e4, which I chose not to do, because in this case black would eliminate my bishop on e3. And actually I want you to see later on that this bishop would have a lot of meaning in this game, all for defensive purposes but also for attacking purposes. So I actually didn't want to allow him to capture it. I played the bishop all the way to c1, which I think it's a very good move. It does two things. First of all, it helps to safeguard my king. If you remember before that, I played the move king to b1 a couple of moves ago, and we told and I've said that this square on c1 will be eventually available for one of my pieces. So here we can see it happening. The bishop helps to safeguard this square on b2, which is very sensitive. You would see it more clearly later on. But the nice thing that this bishop not only defends my king, but also is still attacking his king. So at some point, this bishop might also support my own attack on the king side. This is why this bishop is such a great piece in its current position. Is defending my king and also attacking his own position. So he has a lot of purpose. Now, at this point, black played the move rook to c8. As you can see, black is thinking about initiating his own attack on the queen side, maybe aiming at this pawn on c2. I now played the move pawn to g5, continuing my own attack. One more nice thing about this move, that it denies the square on f6, perhaps for his bishop. Because if at some point this bishop could be landed on f6, this bishop, like my bishop on c1, could be a very strong piece. It could attack my king on the long diagonal, but at the same time protect his own king on g7. So actually with the move g5, I'm not only threatening at some point to take his pawn, but I'm also controlling this square, which is very nice. He now played the move queen to c7, creating this very strong battery of the rook and the queen against my pawn on c2. This is a very big threat. So now I have a couple of ways to deal with it. I kind of like my move. It's possible to take this pawn on e4 once again, but I wanted to bring one of my pieces to the attack, knight to d4. I like this move because now, as my bishop, my knight is now a very flexible piece. It's defending the pawn on c2, which is a very important square, but at the same time, it is also might be at some point a very active piece in the attack. So for example, I can at some point play the move knight f5, and you see suddenly the knight might help me to attack these two weak squares against in front of the king. So knight to d4 and the bishop on c1, you see these are multi-purpose pieces. They defend my king, but they also might assist my own attack on the king side. So knight to d4. Now black played a good move, knight to a4. Black is not waiting for me to checkmate his own king, but he's rather going for his own attack on the queen side. Now with this move, it does two things. It puts pressure against my pawn on b2, but mainly it threatens to go with the knight on c3, forking my king and my rook. I must not allow the move knight to c3. And there is actually only one good way that I have found to deal with this threat. If you want to stop the video and, and start and try to find it yourself, you're very welcome. The move is rook to h3. This is a very nice move because it seems like on the queen side, only the pieces which kind of staying there could assist the king. But actually, white could use this rook on h1, which at the moment is still not doing too much. It didn't move in the game yet in order to play this move rook to h3. And this rook, once again, it's an also now defending my king along the third rank. So, for example, if black tries to play the same move knight to c3, now I can just take it. And after black captures on c3, I can just remove that knight. And I got two knights against my rook, which is a very good deal for me, because now both of black's knights are eliminated, which means that black doesn't really have any attack going, and I can start thinking about my own attack on the king's side. So for example, good moves here would be bishop to b2, attacking the queen and aiming at the long diagonal at this pawn. Another good move would be knight to f5. You see, once again, as we mentioned earlier, this knight might defend the king. Actually, I'm blundering. Here there is queen takes c2. So probably in order to play this move, we need to first chase away this queen from c3 and then at some point play the knight to f5. White's position here, I think it's very good. He's attacking the black king and black's potential attack has been reduced to almost zero. So this is a very bad trade for black. So once again, yes, this is the position. But once again, we can see that many of white's pieces are functioning in two ways: defending the king and also attacking the enemy king. That's a very important thing to keep in mind. Every piece in chess can have more than one purpose, one thing that he's doing currently. This is why I kind of like my position here. So I have a lot of defending pieces on the king, the bishop, the knight, the rook, this rook. It has a lot of defense. So even black has a lot of attacking pieces, I have a lot of defensive units. So I was not worried too much about his attack here. He played the move queen to c5. I think this was a very critical mistake by him. I think he missed my next two moves. I think black should think about safeguarding his king. For example, the move rook to e8 makes a lot of sense to me. This looks like a little move, but it vacates this square for the bishop. And likewise, my bishop on c1. Now this bishop helps to defend the black king much better. And also the black rook is now much more active than it was on f8. It protects the pawn on e4, for example. This would have been a better defensive move in my view. Also, an interesting point, you might notice that I'm not very much in a hurry to capture this pawn on h6, which looks like a very tempting move because I'm threatening checkmate on g7 and I'm also taking a pawn. But that's exactly the point that I did not want to play this move, because now his bishop can finally play the move bishop to f6, defending this pawn on g7, but also attacking my knight on d4 and later on maybe also my king. Now this bishop is very active. And my attack might get stuck, actually, since now this bishop is very well protecting this area. I didn't really want to allow this, because once again, we need to think about our attack, but also against about our king when we try to deliver our attack successfully. He did not play rook e8, though. Once again, he played queen to c5. His idea was probably to put his queen on b4. And renewing some threats of knight to c3 and some threats to the pawn on b2 was probably not the best move. Now I chose to take this pawn on e4 finally. So the queen now also joins the game, and also the queen now has two functions: defending the pawn on c2, defending the knight, but also putting pressure on his pieces. His knight on d5, his bishop on e7 is under attack, and also look at this diagonal. It might be very weak, so at some point I might put my bishop right here, creating this battery which aims at the pawn on h7. So once again, all of my pieces, the queen, the knight, the rook and the bishop, are doing two things at once. And I think that's why white's attack here worked out quite well, because the black pieces are purely on aggressive positions, so they don't protect his king so well. So he's taking greater risks. If his attack wouldn't work, his king will definitely get under very serious pressure. So he finally played the move rook from f to e8, because he realized that he has to protect this bishop. But this fails now tactically. White has actually a fairly simple tactical idea here, which wins material. You might try to find it yourself, stop the video. This move is the simple move knight to b3, attacking the black queen, but also liberating my rook to attack the knight on d5. So now this knight is lost. And once again, we can see the advantages of the move queen to e4, because now this pawn is protected, so this knight could move away. Black played queen to c6. And now I play the move. I could take this knight in two different ways. I can take it with the rook, or I can take it with the queen. The move rook takes d5 is much more obvious, because the move queen takes d5 is allowing black to capture this pawn on c2, which looks extremely dangerous. It's checking my king. My king has to go to the corner. And at first glance, it might look like black is going to checkmate white. But if we look more closely, black cannot do anything for white, because the white's pieces are so well placed in the defense. The bishop on c1, remember that bishop, which we I think we moved this bishop to c1 something like 10 moves ago. And now it's actually distributing a very good defense against this pawn. If this bishop would not exist, it would be checkmate immediately on b2. How great is this bishop? All of my pieces are protected. The rook is protected by the queen. The knight is protected two times, actually. Everything is protected. So I was not worried at all about his attack here. He played now the move knight c5. This was his kind of last chance for counterplay. He was trying to eliminate my knight on b3, because if these two knights get exchanged just like that, black is going to checkmate white with the move queen takes bishop, followed by a rook takes rook with the back rank checkmate. This cannot be really allowed. Now there are actually a lot of good moves that white can try, but I particularly like the move I managed to found, which is the move bishop to d3. So white is in general very happy to exchange pieces at this point, because I'm having the material advantage. I'm having an extra knight on the board, so I really don't mind if you would take my bishop. It will only initiate more exchanges. I would be extremely happy to exchange queens. And there are two very nice tactical points about this move. That it cannot just take my rook on d1, which seems not protected, because now there is bishop h7, check. And when his king takes the bishop, I can very simply take his queen and win the game. This is actually an important detail about this move. Second point, that if he chooses to take my knight on b3, it's also a check. Now I can take back with the pawn, actually, which slightly breaks my pawn structure, but much more importantly, it gives the king a square to move to a2, so nothing really bad can happen to him. So actually, this is what happened. He took on b3, I took with the pawn, and just out of desperation, black played the move queen takes c1, rook takes c1, rook takes c1. Once again, this move could be a checkmate, but there are two legal moves. There is king to a2, which is what I chose, but for this matter, there is also bishop to b1. And after the move king a2, he played rook c5. And after the move queen e4, black actually resigned. There is a threat of checkmate in two moves coming from the h7 square. And also, black is just overwhelmingly down in material, so there is not too much that he can do to save his position. So, hope you enjoy this game. Please let me know in the comments if you like this format, if I try to do more often this kind of videos, or whether the normal format of the online analysis and games is better. And in general, let me know if there are any more ideas that you have, requests, and I will definitely see you very soon. Thank you guys for watching. See you guys. Bye-bye.